who hasn't went through hardships and difficulties in life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدْ. Indeed, we have created man in turmoil. So every person at some point in his life can always refer to this surah for an uplifting moment. Because this is a surah that talks about the hardships of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Another unique thing about this surah is that this is the only place in the Quran where the story of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is mentioned. Now this is very unique, because when you compare this to the stories of other prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we see that their stories are mentioned numerous times in the Quran. The story of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, for instance, is mentioned in at least half a dozen places in the Quran. The story of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam is mentioned in 25 different locations. The story of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam is mentioned in at least a dozen places in the Quran. The story of Nuh alayhi salam, the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, of Idris alayhi salam, of Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam are mentioned in several different places in the Quran. But the story of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is only mentioned in this surah. In fact, even the name Yusuf occurs only in two places outside of the surah. One is in Surah Al-An'am, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a list of the names of some of the prophets, and one of them that is mentioned is Yusuf. وَمِن ذُرِّيَّتِهِ دَاوُدَ وَسُلَيْمَانُ وَأَيُّوبُ وَيُوسُفُ وَمُوسَى وَهَارُونَ. And the other one is in Surah Al-Ghafir, in Surah Al-Mu'min, in the 24th juz of the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ يُوسُفُ مِنْ قَبْلُ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ فَمَا زِلْتُمْ فِي شَكٍّ مِمَّا جَاءَكُمْ بِهِ. Only the names are mentioned, there is no story. The story of what happened to Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is mentioned only and only in this surah. The other unique thing about this surah is that it has one long story as its main theme, a unified story as its main theme. And you will never find this anywhere else in the Quran. You will never find a surah, or at least a surah of this size, that has one long story as its main theme. Yes, you would find small surahs like Surah Al-Fil, Surah Al-Quraysh, Surah Al-Falaq, Surah Al-Nas, but they're only 3 or 4 lines, 5 lines, half a page maybe. But you will never find a surah of this length which has one long story as its main theme. Therefore, it makes this surah very, very unique. And this is a surah that each and every single one of us can benefit from, whether young or old, because it's a story, and we know stories are very, very interesting and very, very attractive. Therefore, even the young ones, those who don't have much in-depth knowledge of the tafsir, even they can also benefit from this surah. So it's a very, very unique surah and one of a kind of surah. And for this reason, I have chosen this surah for the tafsir. Now, before I actually start the tafsir, I would like to just mention some few introductory points regarding this surah. Number one, when was this surah revealed? Because when you understand the circumstances in which a surah is revealed, you understand the, as they call it in the Arabic language, the mufassirun, سبب النزول, the cause of revelation, of when the surah was revealed, why it was revealed, then you appreciate the surah a lot more. So scholars have mentioned few reasons as to why the surah was revealed. It is said this surah was revealed at a time which was the most difficult for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There probably wasn't a time or a period in the seerah of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam where he went through more difficulty than this period. And for this reason, the scholars have called this year عام الحزن, the year of sorrow or the year of grief. Because there was 3 devastating events that occurred in the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what made it even more difficult is that they happened one after the other. There isn't a period which was more depressing or in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was more demoralized than this period. And for this reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this surah to give some comfort and solace to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first of these 3 events was the most intimate and personal to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that was the death of Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. We know that Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha was very, very close to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she was very, very loved by Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as they say, behind every great man, there is a great woman. And this was exactly applying to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. Whenever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam faced any difficulty, he faced any hardship, it was Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha who would give him words of comfort and solace. And we all know the famous incident of the first few verses of Surah Al-Alaq when they were revealed, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had his first encounter with Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very frightened and scared, and he started to rush down the mountain. Whose house did he go to? None other than the house of Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. And it was Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha who comforted Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said that do not worry, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not let any harm be done to you, for you are a person who is very hospitable to the guests, who is very generous, who helps the orphans, who helps the widows. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not let any harm be done to you. So it was Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha who gave words of comfort to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She was his internal support inside the house. And scholars say that when a person has that comfort inside the house, he can face the difficulties of the outside with a lot of ease. But when he's deprived of this benefit, then the problems of the outside becomes even more difficult for him to bear. So the death of Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha was indeed very, very difficult for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then a few weeks later, it was then followed by another death. And that was the death of his uncle, Abu Talib. Although Abu Talib was not a Muslim, he never accepted Islam, and he died as a mushrik and as a pagan, but he always protected and defended the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was always there to support Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is said initially, some of the Quraysh, they came to Abu Talib to kind of persuade his nephew to stop propagating this deen, you know, about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and monotheism, tawheed, and the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And initially, he kind of gave in. And he came to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, oh my nephew, do not place a burden on me that I cannot bear. And at that moment, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made some very emotional comments. He said to his uncle, he said, oh my uncle, even if they were to give me the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left hand. In other words, even if they were to give me full authority, still I will not stop propagating this deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me this responsibility, and therefore it is my mission, my duty, to propagate it to others. When Abu Talib heard these words from him, he said, oh my nephew, do whatever you have to do, do whatever you like to do, you would have my protection. And he was a man of his words. And for 10 years, none of the Quraysh were able to lay their hands on Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because Abu Talib was the chieftain of Makkah, and the Arabs, they respected that. When a person would give protection to another person, they would respect the protection of that person. So none of the pagans of Makkah were able to harm Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in any physical way when Abu Talib was alive. And he was always there for the Muslims. He was always there, and he suffered along with the Muslims when they went through all of those hardships and difficulties. There was a time when many of the Muslims, they were boycotted. Banu Hashim, they were boycotted from the rest of the Quraysh. Quraysh was a big tribe, and within it, there were smaller tribes. There was a small clan known as Banu Hashim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was from this clan. So all of the Muslims that accepted Islam from Banu Hashim, all of them were boycotted from the rest of the Quraysh. They were not supposed to have any business dealings, any relationship with any of them. And it became so difficult that some of them even died almost died because of starvation. And Abu Talib was the one who left all of his comfort back home in Mecca and went to live with the Muslims outside of Mecca in the desert. Even though he was not a subject of that boycott, because he was not a Muslim, he was a pagan, he was a mushrik, and he was a chieftain. But he thought and he saw this as a form of oppression and injustice, and he thought that he had to do this as the protector and as the defender and as the uncle of the Prophet. He was always there to support Rasul. Whereas Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha was his internal support in the house, Abu Talib was his external support in society. And these two deaths, they occurred within a few weeks. And this was indeed very, very difficult for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after the death of Abu Talib, then the persecution, it got intensified. And it got to such an extent that few years after that, they even decided unanimously that they had to, na'udhu billah, assassinate the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they even sent an assassination squad to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But eventually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These were the two incidents that happened. After this, it was followed by another incident. As if things could not get any worse, there was still yet another incident that was to happen. And this was probably the most difficult day on Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There isn't a day in the seat of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that is more difficult than this incident, which occurred after the death of Abu Talib. And that is the incident of At-Taif. Once Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she said, O Messenger of Allah, was there any day that was more difficult upon you than the day of Uhud? Okay? In Medina, there isn't a day that was more difficult than the day of Uhud. In Medina. And Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was very young to know anything about Mecca. She grew up in Medina, and she knew the problems of Medina, of Badr, Uhud, Tabuk, and everything else that happened in Medina. And we know that the most difficult in Medina was the incident of Uhud, where the Prophet ﷺ was hurt not spiritually and emotionally, but also physically. That a person had taken an arrow, and he threw it at the Prophet ﷺ, and it was embedded in the cheek of the Prophet ﷺ, and two of the links from his armor were embedded deep inside his cheek. And when it was pulled out, it is said the blood started to gush forth from his cheek. And he was bleeding profusely. And it was indeed a very, very difficult day for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was curious. And she said, O Messenger of Allah, was there any day that was more difficult upon you than the day of Uhud? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes, there was a day. Immediately he responded, spontaneously, without even thinking. He said, yes, there was a day which was more difficult than the incident of Uhud. And that was the incident of Taif. And what is the incident of Taif? This was an incident that happened before the Hijrah, before the Prophet ﷺ migrated to Medina. Eventually, Rasulullah ﷺ migrated to Medina, and therefore that was the city Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for Islam. But before that, the Prophet ﷺ was intending to go to Taif, hoping that maybe the people would accept Islam and that could be the center of Islam. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went there to speak to the chieftains, hoping that he would get, a very warm welcome from the people. But instead of that, they rejected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All of the chieftains, not only did they reject the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they even started to mock Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they went to the extent of telling the youth of Taif to go and stone the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And literally he was stoned and he was chased out of that city. It is said he bled so much that the blood oozing from his body was so much when it dried that the sandals were stuck to his heels. And even in that state, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not make dua against them, but he made dua for them. This was the most difficult day for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and all of these events occurred one after the other. Within just few weeks, within 4 to 6 weeks, all of these incidents occurred. Also, another reason some scholars have mentioned regarding the revelation of this surah is that some of the sahaba, they came to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asking for the stories of the earlier people. When the persecution got intensified and the sahaba, they were getting overwhelmed with all of the pressures, they came to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they wanted to hear some words, some stories of the earlier people who also went through the same hardships and difficulties. Because when you hear stories of other people who go through the same difficulties and hardships in life as you, you get some comfort and solace from it. So therefore they came to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the surah. We know the hardships that the sahaba went through, especially the early muhajirun, like Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Khabbab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. It is said about Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu that he will be made to lie on the scorching sand of Medina during midday. And a huge boulder will be placed on his chest, and he would be ordered to renounce Islam. And even in that state, what would he say? Ahad, ahad. I still believe in the one and true God. I still believe in the one and true God. It is said about Khabbab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that he will be placed on hot charcoal, and the blood oozing from his body would put away the fire. They will punish them in such a way that they will not die, but will give them a slow, painful punishment. That the person will not die, but he will just be on the verge of death. This is how many of the Sahaba and the companions, they were persecuted and how they were persecuted and how they were punished. So when they were going through all of these hardships, they asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to hear a story of the earlier people. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Surah Yusuf. Another direct reason for the revelation of the surah, which is mentioned by some of the scholars, is that the pagans of Mecca, they wanted to outwit the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They wanted to show to the people that he is not really a prophet, a true messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they sent a delegation to Medina, to Yathrib. Yathrib, which is the former name of Medina. And they asked the people over there if they can, give these people a trick question whereby they can ask Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam and know once and for all, and to prove to the people that he is not really a true prophet and messenger of Allah. So they sent a delegation to the Yahud of Yathrib, to the Jews of Medina. Because the pagans of Mecca, they felt that the Jews and the Christians, they were superior to them. They had this inferiority complex because they felt they had a scripture, they had a prophet, and therefore, in that sense, they were right. that yes, the people of the book, the Jews and Christians, were much better than the pagans in Mecca, were just worshipping idols, were pure idol worshippers, whereas the Jews and Christians, they at least had a divine scripture, they had a prophet. So in that sense, they were superior to them, and even the Quran has, you know, categorized them into two groups. One are the Mushrikeen, and the other one is Ahli Kitab, and the rules of Ahli Kitab are different than that of the pagans, because they still, you know, there's still truth in their books. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so they came to the Yahud of Medina, and the question they posed to them was, ask Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the story of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam and his brothers. If he's able to answer this question, then he is a true prophet and messenger of Allah. Otherwise, he's an imposter. He's a false prophet. And it's interesting why they chose this question. Because the Arabs had nothing to do with the lineage of Ishaq alayhi salatu wasalam. We know Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam had two sons, Ismail alayhi salam and Ishaq alayhi salam. Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam is the ancestor of the Arabs. There was no prophet that came from the lineage of Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam, except for the last and final prophet, the seal of all the prophets, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Whereas from the lineage of Ishaq alayhi salatu wasalam, there are many prophets that came, hundreds and maybe even thousands of prophets that came from the lineage of Ishaq alayhi salatu wasalam. The son of Ishaq was Yaqub alayhi salam. Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam had 12 sons. One was Yusuf alayhi salam, the other one was Binyamin, and then 10 more sons. You have these 12 sons, and hence you have the 12 tribes of Bani Israel, the 12 tribes of the Israelites, or as we say it in the English vernacular, the Jews. So the Jews, they were from the lineage of Ishaq alayhi salatu wasalam. The Arabs, they were from the lineage of Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam. So they had no relationship, no connection with the lineage of Ishaq alayhi salatu wasalam. They probably never even heard up to that moment about Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. They probably never even heard the name. And even if they did, they definitely didn't know the story of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, because obviously he was not their ancestor. So they went back to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasalam with this question. And they said, tell us the story of Yusuf and his brothers. And as soon as they posed this question before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam came with Surah Yusuf, with the entire Surah Yusuf. Inna anzalnahu Qur'anan arabiyyan la'allakum ta'qilun. And then the next ayah, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ بِمَا أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. Indeed, we relate unto you the best of stories, because we have revealed this Qur'an to you, when كُنْتَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ لَمِنَ الْغَافِلِينَ. And verily, before this, you are of those who were unaware. Okay, غافلين does not mean one who is misguided. This is not how we should translate this. When it comes to the Prophet ﷺ, it means one who was unaware, did not know the details of how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he did not have the path of the Qur'an yet. And why? Because the Qur'an was not yet revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in this sense, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِن كُنْتَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ لَمِنَ الْغَافِلِينَ. Verily before this, you are of those who are of ghafilin, those who are unaware. Now inshallah we'll do the tafsir of the first ayah of this surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins the surah by saying, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام را تلك آيات الكتاب المبين ألف لام را. These are the verses of the clear book. Now what is the meaning of ألف لام را? These are mysterious letters of the Quran. Many surahs of the Quran, they begin with this. Surah Al-Baqarah ألف لام ميم, Surah Al-Imran ألف لام ميم, ياسين حاميم كاف هايا عين صاد حاميم عين سين قاف قاف صاد. Many of the surahs, they begin with these letters. No one really knows their meaning. Okay, these are known as حروف مقطعات, the broken letters. Because you don't join them, you say them separately. You spell them out separately. Alif, Lam, Mim. And in this surah, the حروف مقطعات are Alif, Lam, Ra. Now the question is, what is the meaning of these mysterious letters? Wallahu A'lam, no one knows for sure. No one knows as to the meaning of these letters. However, scholars have come up with some opinions. They have mentioned some reason as to why perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned these names. And these are just opinions, some of which even go back to the Sahaba. So there's no harm in mentioning these opinions. But at the end, they're just opinions, just speculations. At the end, wallahu a'lam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So some scholars have mentioned that perhaps these represent the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So alif represents Allah, you know, lam represents latif, you know, ra perhaps may represent Rahman or Rahim. This is just an opinion. Wallahu alam, it doesn't have really a sound base to it, but this is an opinion. A very interesting, and there's more than like 26 different opinions the scholars have mentioned. Some say this is perhaps maybe the name of the surah, so on and so forth. But there's a very, very interesting opinion mentioned by Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. And he said that basically Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is almost taunting the people of Quraysh. That look, this is the Quran that is made of letters that you write, of words that you speak, of language that you speak. These are the same letters to try to bring something like the Quran. If you notice, immediately after the huruf al-muqatta'at, there is always some mention of the Quran. Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alif Lam Mim, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ يَاسِين وَالْقُرْآنِ الْحَكِيمِ صَاد وَالْقُرْآنِ الذِّكْرِ قَاف وَالْقُرْآنِ الْمَجِيدِ. In almost every single case, except maybe for two or three cases, in every situation, the ayah comes immediately, the ayah immediately after حروف مقاطعات has something to do with the Quran. But when it comes to two or three places, it is not the second ayah, but maybe the third or fourth ayah. And if you count all of the حروف مقاطعات, you see that they come to 14 letters. And the alphabet, the Arabic alphabet, has about 28 letters, if you consider Hamza and Alif as one. So Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says that, Wallahu a'lam, you know, this is just what some of the scholars kind of read into this. There's some symbolic meaning that perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling the Quraysh that here, this is half of the alphabet, bring another half of the alphabet and try to bring something like the Quran. It is made of the same letters, the same words that you speak, but try to see if you can bring something like the Quran. Alif Lam Ra. These are letters, and again, there's nothing really mentioned in the hadith. The only thing that is mentioned regarding this is the hadith of At-Tirmidhi, where Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man qara harfan min kitabillahi falahu bihi hasana wal hasanatu ashru amthaliha." That one who recites one letter from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will get one reward, and each reward will be multiplied by 10. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "La aqulu alif lam mim harf." I do not mean to say the alif lam mim is one letter, walakin alif harfun, walam harfun, wa mim harfun. But alif is one letter, lam is another letter, and mim is another letter. So just by reciting alif lam mim, one gets 30 blessings. Actually, there's a lot more to this ayah. We inshallah do the tafsir of this ayah and perhaps maybe the second ayah next week, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. Wa akhir da'wana. Alhamdulillah.